Hey, Sister Chantel, how you doing? Amen, amen, amen. Hey, Sister Clara, good evening, good evening. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Amen, amen, amen. I pray that you all have had a wonderful and amazing day. Hey, Sister Genevia, Sister Jackson, how you doing? Sister Stevens, how you doing? Hey, Sister Lena, how you doing? Amen, amen. God bless you. Real good, amen, is my prayer. Hey, how you doing? My little nephew, how you doing, brother? Amen, good to see you, amen. Sister Sandra, how you doing on this evening? Amen, amen, amen. How you doing, my mother-in-law? Amen, hey, Sister Sarah, how you doing on this evening? Amen, amen, amen. Hey, Sister Courtney, good evening, good evening, good evening. Blessed, amen, blessed. Amen, amen, amen. Nobody should have to tell you that you're blessed. You ought to know, amen, that you are blessed. Amen, praise the Lord. Amen, Sister Rito, good evening. Hey, Sister Emma, how you doing? Amen, amen. Good to see you all on tonight. Amen, amen. Hey, Miss Johnson, how you doing? Amen, good to see you. Good to see you, amen, amen, amen. Hey, how you doing? I thank God for this evening, and I thank God for his many, many, many blessings. Amen. Every now and again, you ought to just take time, even when you're asking God for something, before you ask him for something, you ought to take time to tell him thank you. Thank you that you have made it through these trying times. Thank you that, you know, it could have been you that some things happened to. Amen. It could have been you that had gone through some things that other people might have experienced. It may have been you, amen. And so you got to thank God sometimes for what he kept from you, amen. So you ought to take time to just thank him sometimes, amen. Thank him sometimes even for those hard times that you had and those lessons that you had to learn, and now you are better off because of, amen. So you've got to give God the praise. You've got to give God the glory, the honor that he really and truthfully deserves. Amen, amen, amen. I'm going to start out on this evening, and I just want to share, amen, a brief song with you on tonight, and we'll get into tonight's lesson, and we're going to see what God has for us on tonight, and I pray that it blesses you in some kind of way, and that you are richly and truly blessed by what it is that God has for us on tonight. Amen, amen. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, said I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Who gave it to me? Yeah, Jesus gave it to me. Oh, and I'm gonna let it shine. Whoa. Jesus gave it to me, well, and I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, Jesus gave it to me, yeah, and I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Amen, amen. Amen. You've got to let your light shine. God has put a light in you wherever you go. Amen. Praise the Lord. You ought to let your light shine. And when you let that light shine, amen, people ought to get a glimpse of glory. Amen. They ought to get a glimpse of who God is by looking at you, by watching you, and by seeing you go through the things that you go through in your day to day. So we thank God, amen, for giving us his light, amen. And we thank God, amen, for being God. Amen. On tonight, We are going to share word that God has shared with us. And I pray it blesses you in some kind of way. Amen. Our scripture will come from the book of Matthew. Amen. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse 48. Matthew chapter 5, verse 48. Amen. The word of God says this. It says, therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Amen. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof fadeth away, but the word of our Lord shall stand forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, I say thank you. I thank you for this time and hour that you've allowed me to speak up for you. It is my prayer, Lord, that your people are blessed. And Lord, I decrease so that you may increase and show up and show out. And it is my prayer, dear God, that you have your way on tonight. And it is my prayer, dear God, that all of us, Lord, leave here better than the way we came and tuned in. We love you, praise you, and we thank you. Lord, I pray you use this vessel as you see fit. And Lord, that you use me until you use me up. It's in Jesus' mighty name I do pray. Amen. And amen again. Amen. Truly God is good and he is good all of the time. Tonight we're going to take a look at the idea of perfection. Amen. Perfection. Amen. Now, we're going to take a look at perfection from the eyes of the word and from how the word of God wants us to see perfection. But I'm going to actually use other illustrations to prove the point of what perfection really is. Amen. In the word of God, we have Christ speaking, and he's speaking to his disciples. And he's come down to the end of chapter number 5, and he shared this with the multitudes, with the people that were around, the people that were listening to him, and what we call the Sermon on the Mount. And so he shared these words. He says, therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Now, here's the thing. If you take a look at the text from the wrong set of eyes, then and only then will you misinterpret what the text is actually saying. One thing you better not get from the text is that you are on God's level. No, it says just as or like. So how many of you know that there's some characteristics that we should have because we are children of God. So we've got to understand that because we are children of God, that really and truthfully, that we have to have certain characteristics in order to say that we are children of God. So it says this. It says, therefore, be perfect. Now, here's the thing. When you take a look at that word perfect, if you don't watch it, you look at it the wrong way. Because in our society, many times we call people perfectionists, right? We call people perfectionists because they want to get everything. They want to get everything right. Amen. They want to get everything just like they want to get it. They want to make sure every I is dotted, every T is crossed, and they want to make sure everything is in line. But when you take a look at the perfection in the text, it has nothing to do with being flawless. Because how many of you know that just today, or can testify that just today, that there's some things you've done to where you know you've fallen short of the glory of God? So God really and truthfully is not expecting you to be flawless. Well, wait a minute, preacher. Help me out with that. He would have never sent Jesus Christ to die on your behalf and give you the grace that you need if that was the truth. No, when we take a look at the text, the perfection of being perfect in the text, it deals with being complete. It deals with being grown up. When you take a look at the perfect in the text, all it's saying is that you ought to be a mature individual in the Lord. See, you've got to understand, if you take a look at chapter 5, it talks about how you ought to love your enemies. It talks about how you ought to pray for them and bless those that despitefully use you. It talks about how you ought to actually love the same ones, amen, that actually do things to literally, intentionally hurt you, amen. So when you get down to 48, it tells us that we ought to be perfect just as our Father is perfect, because it's letting us know that God reigns, right? He allows reign on the just and the unjust, the Christian and the sinner, the good and the bad. So the Bible is telling us that we ought to be mature. There ought to be some things we do to handle the situations that we come across that make us look like Jesus Christ, that allow us to look like the God that we say that we serve. So the Bible is saying that we ought to be perfect just as God. God woke up the sinner this morning. God woke you up this morning. God woke up the one who committed a heinous crime this morning, and he woke up the one who walks holy and righteous. So God is saying this. He's saying you've got to be perfect just like he is perfect, and understand that he's no respecter of persons. And we've got to understand that when we live in this life, that guess what? We can't look around at other folk as if they're so bad and we're so good, because the Bible clearly says there's none good, no, not one. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we've got to understand that the perfect in this text is letting us know that we ought to be mature. We ought to be able to handle life's issues in a mature Christian way. We ought to be able to handle life in a way to where when we react to life, to where we don't look like the world. We ought to act in a way to where we know that we serve an awesome, risen Savior. So when you take a look at the perfect in the text, it deals with the finished product. It deals with not lacking or complete with everything, mannered, amen, mature and grown up, amen, amen, praise the Lord. The older I get, I realize that age has nothing to do with being grown up, amen, amen, praise the Lord. Because I've determined and I've discovered that there are some people that are high in age, but they are low in their level of being grown up. So God is saying this, that we've got to be mature, and we've got to act in a way to where we understand that we ought to look more like God and less like the world, and less walking in the flesh. So now let's take a look at perfection. Let's take a look at true marks of what perfection really and truthfully looks like. See, many people, really and truthfully, they mark a person being mature or grown up by different things. But God has shown me a long time ago that we can actually put on a facade as if we are one thing, when in actuality, we are something else. Right? Okay, Pastor, help me out with that. You've got to understand, real, true perfection and maturity, it shows up when certain folks are looking, when nobody is looking. It shows up when the room is crowded, and it shows up when nobody else is around. Real, true maturity shows up, amen, praise the Lord, and you don't need no influence. You don't need nobody pushing you. No, it's the Holy Spirit leading and guiding and directing you to do the things that you should do. Well, Pastor, what are the true marks of maturity? I'm so glad you asked me that. The first true mark of maturity is discernment. Amen. It is discernment. And the scripture I'm going to refer to as it relates to discernment, I'm going to go to Hebrews chapter 5, verse numbers 12 through 14. And look what it says in the Word of God. So the first mark of perfection of being mature is discernment, right? Now, when you take a look at Hebrews 5, 12 and 14, I'm going to show you what discernment really is. It says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food, for everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of, watch what it says, of full age. Some of your translations might say, who are mature. That is, those by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Okay, Pastor, help me out with that. So you've got to understand, when you deal with being or having discernment, really and truthfully, it deals with you having a knowledge and an understanding of the Word of God so that you can get an idea of what right and what wrong is. And so now that you have an idea of what right and wrong is by the Word of God, now you can look at life, you can look at your situations, you can look at people, you can look at the things you go through, and because you have what you need and you've also been being aware of what's around you because you know the Word and you've been practicing the Word, you've been living the Word, now when you see evil, you know what it looks like. Now when you see good, you know what it looks like. And now you are, or you have discernment, and you are disciplined in what it is that you are doing. It says this, it says, for reason, use their senses, right? Exercise, right? So what that means is that you cannot just expect, amen, praise the Lord, to just grow in the Lord and not practice what the Word of God says. It says you have to exercise your senses. So that lets me know that over time, as you go through life, over time, as you read the Word, over time, as God reveals things to you, He'll allow you to discern good, amen, from evil. He'll allow you to discern what's of the devil and what is of God. And a true person who's mature can identify, amen, when God is at work, and can identify when the enemy is at work, and they'll be able to discern right from what is wrong. Amen. Too many times, believers are bamboozled. Too many times, believers are weak. Too many times, believers are taken advantage of only because they don't exercise their senses to be able to discern what is of God and what is not of God. And when you take a look at Hebrews 5, it talks about the Word. It talks about false teachers. It talks about the things that you're exposed to. It talks about the things that you go through. And it says that you should be able to discern those things. I want to help somebody on tonight. Some of you are in relationships, amen, praise the Lord, where you know that you're in an unhealthy relationship. You know you done hooked up with somebody that you shouldn't have hooked up with. And you befriended somebody, and you know that the Lord has already showed you. But you know what has happened? You've allowed your feelings, you've allowed your emotions to cause you not to discern what is right from what is wrong. And now you end up way down the line, you trying to figure out what somebody that already told you. Amen. Praise the Lord. So you got to get that, amen, in your spirit to understand that God will give you discernment. Amen. Praise the Lord. There's some times in our life, amen, that we've got to understand that God will put us in a position
to be able to see the things in our life, amen, that have come along to try to take advantage of us in certain situations. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay, Pastor, you said the first thing is discernment, right? True mark of true perfection is discernment. Well, the next mark of true perfection, amen, praise the Lord, is patience. Amen. Turn your Bible, if you will, to the book of James, and you'll find that patience is a mark of true maturity. I'm going to show you in the word what I mean. When you take a look at the word of God, and you take a look at what it says, and you go to James chapter 1. Amen. Praise the Lord. James chapter 1. It talks about allowing yourself to go through the things that you go through, and allowing yourself to be able to grow and to learn, amen, from the things that you're going through. Amen. Praise the Lord. James chapter 1, we're going to take a look at verse, amen, number 2 through number 4. It says this. It says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Amen. Lacking nothing. Amen. It says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. You've got to understand that a true mark of perfection is patience. How many of us understand that in this life that you're going to go through different trials and you're going to go through different tribulations? There's some stuff that's going to come your way that really and truthfully are going to come. And if you don't watch it, it'll blow your mind and it'll knock you off your feet. But you've got to understand this one thing. You've got to understand that your trials did not come, amen, to break you. It didn't come to tear you down. They didn't come to destroy you. No, God will use the things that you go through, amen, to produce something in you that you wouldn't have gotten if you wouldn't have gone through what you went through. Oh, Jesus, have mercy. Somebody got to hear this. Some of you are asking God to allow you to grow, okay? Well, help. I have to help somebody. You want to grow? Can I help you? There's some stuff God got to allow you to go through. There's some stuff that you've got to. There's some things that you've got to actually feel. There's some tears you're going to have to cry. There's some bumps you're going to have to acquire. There's some bruises that you're going to have to get. Why? Because you've got to understand, in order to get to that patience, amen, guess what? You've got to go through some trials and some tribulations. And see, the true mark of true maturity is patience. Well, wait a minute, preacher. How do you know that? When an individual is able to deal with life's issues, amen, where it might knock you down, but it won't knock you out. Amen. Praise the Lord. So you got to understand that the true mark, a true mark of maturity, amen, praise the Lord, is patience. Amen. How many of you know and can testify that many times people don't want to go through the things that they go through? Nobody wants to feel hurt. Nobody wants to feel pain. Nobody wants to go through. Nobody wants to feel anything. But you've got to understand this one thing. See, don't you dare live a life where you take stuff to numb the pain. Don't you dare live life to where you run to this and you run to that so you forget about your problems. Don't you dare live a life to where you try to run away from the stuff that you're going through. No, you've got to be able to get to the point to understand that all things work together for the good of those that are the called and love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose. That's some growth that God wants to get in you. Because why? Because he wants you to be a better Christian. He wants you to be a better person. He wants you to be a better husband. He wants you to be a better wife. He wants you to be a better employee. He wants you to be a better son. He wants you to be a better daughter. And there's some things you've got to go through in order, amen, to get there. I'm reminded, amen, praise the Lord. I'm reminded of those who play sports. And you've got to understand this one thing. Many a times, people want to be this and they want to be that and they want to be the other. But you see, you've got to understand, those individuals who are able to perform on a higher level have gone through enough tough moments. They've gone through enough tough situations. They've gone through enough experience where they've seen this and they've seen that to where now they're able to endure, they're able to handle the level that they're on because now they've experienced some things to help get them to that level. Can I help somebody? Stop running from your problem. Stop complaining about your problem. Stop running away from the things you know that are there to help develop you. And you say, Lord, guess what? I know you're with me. I know you got me. And Lord, I'm going with you all the way. And whatever you want me to learn in this situation, Lord, I want the patience I need to be able to keep on going. Somebody can testify on tonight that you're better off now, amen, praise the Lord, than you were a couple of years ago. Only because, amen, not all the good stuff you went through, because of some of the tough moments that God allowed you to experience, right? So you got to get that in your spirit that, guess what, patience is a true mark of perfection. Not being flawless, no, but being mature in the Lord and handling life the right way. Amen. Amen and praise. Praise the Lord. Well, Pastor, help me out. You said this. You said that one true mark of perfection, amen, was discernment. Another true mark of perfection is patience. Pastor, what's the last one that you want to tell me? I'm so glad you asked. The last mark of true perfection is unity. Amen. Amen. And amen. Again, it is patience. And if you will, turn your Bibles to Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4. Amen. And we're going to take a look at Ephesians 4. And we're going to look at verses 13, amen, through 16, amen. Verses 13 through 16, amen. Ephesians 4, 13 through 16. Look what it says. It says this. It says that till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man. Watch it now. To a perfect man. Mature man or woman. To the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. By the trickery of men. In the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. Watch it now. But speaking the truth in love may grow up. Watch it. In all things. Into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knit together by what every joint supplies according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Amen. Praise the Lord. A true mark of perfection is unity. Amen. Amen and praise the Lord. It is unity. The Bible talks about coming to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. So you've got to understand this one thing. That's what helps us as believers, amen, to be strong as the body of Christ, amen. It's to have unity, amen, of the faith, and also, amen, not just unity of the faith, but the knowledge of the Son of God, who is Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, and us together, one with the other, with one accord, with one mind, amen, praise the Lord, thinking on the same things, doing the same things, going in the same direction, amen, and knowing without a shadow of a doubt what God has said together, guess what, through unity, amen, maturity can be attained. Look what it says. It says, to a perfect man, watch it now, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Amen. Unity in the word, unity in our faith, unity in what we know and what we know about Christ. And look what it says. It says that we no longer be children, what, tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. I want to show you something that really and truthfully that we miss in the Word of God. You are actually vital and important to my growth. I am vital and important to your growth. That's why unity is one of a key true measure or mark of maturity, because what ends up happening, a person who is unified understands and knows that, guess what, they are better with their brother and sister in Christ. They are better with others than they are by themselves. And I'm going to show you what the word says. It says, from the whom the whole body joined and knit together, by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share. Check it out. Causes growth of the body for the edifying, Lord have mercy, of itself in love. Amen. See, those who are unified, those who understand that unity is important, they understand and they are real mature believers. They are matured in Christ because they understand that really and truthfully, it's not just me. It's not just you. It's we. We are the body of Christ. And when you take a look at unity, unity tells you when you are unified, when you want to work things together, when you want everybody to grow together, when you want to include people, you've got to understand that that is a true mark of maturity, because you understand and know that, guess what, your growth is tied to you being unified. Amen. Amen. And praise the Lord. And I want to share with you this one thing, that really and truthfully, that as believers, we've got to walk not in our own understanding, not in what we think, not in our own opinion, not in what we think we know. No, we have got to walk, amen, praise the Lord, in what we know about, amen, what we know about Jesus, and we've got to walk in what we know about what God has shared with us. And we've got to know that when in doing God's business, we've got to have, number one, we've got to have discernment. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's a mark of true maturity. You're not able to be tossed to and fro. Amen. You're not able, amen, to be thrown here and thrown there and not taken advantage of. No, true maturity. Amen. Amen. True maturity is marked by discernment. That's why, amen, they don't allow children, amen, to do some stuff that adults should be able to do. Amen. Praise the Lord. So discernment is a mark of true maturity. Also patience. Amen. An individual who is patient, amen, it's a mark of maturity. They've gone through some stuff. They've been through some stuff. Amen. They're able to handle some stuff. And some of y'all looking at folk and y'all envying folk and y'all being jealous of folk and you trying to be like folk and you don't know all the hell some folk had to go through to get what they got and to get where they are and the patience that they have, they got it only because the Lord allowed them to go through some stuff. So you better stop walking around trying to, oh, I want to be like you. Oh, you just all that. Oh, you just amaze me. You guess what? Some folks they'll have to sit you down and say, okay, you want to be like me? Let me tell you some of the trials I had to go through. Let me tell you some of the tears that I had to cry. Let me tell you some of the stuff that I had to deal with to get what I got and to get where I am. But you've got to understand this one thing, that guess what? If you want to be grown up, amen, you got to go through. Amen. Praise the Lord. I pray I help somebody with that on tonight. But on the last one is unity. Amen. Show me somebody who's always causing division, who's always trying to break stuff up, always trying to throw this aside, always trying to throw that to the side, always trying to talk about people, always trying to bash somebody, always trying to badmouth somebody, always trying to tear somebody down, always trying to do stuff to dismantle stuff. And I show you somebody who really and truthfully is not mature. And can I help you? You got some old babies. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you didn't know that, not you know. Amen. Praise the Lord. But you've got to understand that these are marks of true perfection. Amen. Discernment. Amen. Discernment. Amen. Pray for wisdom. Pray for understanding. Pray that God will show you his word. Pray that God would bring his word back to your remembrance. Amen. Some of y'all been praying for patience. Well, get ready. All hell about to break loose. Get ready. And I'm not calling nothing on your life. The Bible says it. Count it all joy when you go through various trials, right? Because it's going to produce something in you that you wouldn't have got if you wouldn't have gone through it. Amen. And the last one is unity. Amen. Praise the Lord. Unity. Amen. Unity. Unity. Right? Somebody who's mature understands that it's not all about them. Somebody who's mature understands that there's a bigger picture that they need to look at instead of just looking at the little world that they're looking in, right? Somebody who's mature understands that they can do more together than they can apart. Let's be real. Sometimes we all do it. We get up in our feelings. Amen. We forget about the big picture. We forget about what we got to be doing at that moment. But can I help you? A true mark of maturity says this. Yeah, I know it ain't like I want it to be. But guess what? It's bigger than me. Amen. Praise the Lord. And some of you can testify. Amen. Praise the Lord. That the Lord has allowed you to experience some things to where you looked at life, not from your own world, but at what? Looking at it what? At that bigger picture that's out there. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I pray the word bless you on tonight. So when you take a look at perfection, don't think you're going to be flawless. Amen. Amen. But you will be mature. Amen. If you got an art with your brother, you don't want to get it right. Amen. Amen. They got something around you. Spirit ain't right. Guess what? God's going to allow you to see that. Amen. They got some stuff you're going to go through. Amen. And you'll be able to handle it a little bit better because you done went through it. Amen. See, that's all marks of maturity. And you'll be able to look at that bigger picture and understand that it ain't all about you, but it's about what God wants us to accomplish. Amen. Bless you. Amen. Praise you. I pray you are blessed. Amen. On tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord. I thank God. Amen. For being God. I know some of y'all saw my paper went that way. Amen. Praise the Lord. But I thank the Lord. He put it in my spirit. Amen. Amen. I thank the Lord. And see, I want to share that with you. I didn't have to share that with you, but I'm going to share it with you. See, sometimes we want life to go perfect. I wanted them notes right there. Them notes say, come find me. Amen. Praise the Lord. And the Lord said, guess what? Now you got to depend on me. See, what happens is we want to be perfect in the worldly sense. What, we want everything to be just right. We don't want no glitches. We don't want nothing to happen. We don't want nothing to go out of the way. And guess what God does? God put us in a position to understand that, guess what? I know you had a plan, but guess what? I'm going to show you my plan. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. I thought about going and get it. I said, no, Lord, it's me and you. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I thank God for being God, and I thank God for his grace, because it's through his grace that what he does is where we're deficient, amen, where we're deficient, right, God stands up, right, and he makes the difference. So I want to help somebody on tonight. You may be going through, or you may be trying to accomplish something. You may feel weak. You may feel inadequate. But you got to understand, anything God called you to, he'll bring you through it. Anything God called you to, right, he'll give you the strength you need. So when you're weak, he'll show you that he is strong, and he'll stand with you and what it is that you're doing. So don't you fret. Don't you cry. Don't you faint. You stay the course, and you do what God has called you to do, and you let the Lord, you let the Lord do what he's going to do. Amen. Bless you here. Amen. God bless you real good is my prayer. Amen. I'm praying, amen, for you all. Amen. On tonight. And I'm praying that you all would continue to do what you need to do to stay safe in these times. Amen. We're going through some turbulent times, but we know we need Jesus in the midst of this. And so just stay the course. Stay on your knees. Amen. Seek the Lord. Amen. Don't stop doing what you're doing. Keep working. Keep praying. Keep fasting. And allow God to work through you and speak to you and minister to you in these times. Amen. This is when God actually allows us to develop in tough times. And I'm going to tell you this, is that really and truthfully, the things God has allowed me to acquire and accomplish and be able to do, I know that, guess what, he had to put me through some stuff to get me where I am. But I thank God, because it made me who I am. And he ain't done with me yet. And he's not done with you either. Amen. So God bless you real good is my prayer. And I pray that you are blessed. Amen. On this wonderful, wonderful evening. Amen. If it is your desire to give, amen, you can give. Amen. Three methods you can give: through the Tithely app. Amen. You can text to give. You can also mail in your gifts, 103 Sackett Road. Amen. Port Bear, Louisiana, 75577. Amen. Whatever you desire to do, I'm going to thank those who have been giving. Amen. And I just pray that God will just continue to keep you and hold you in his hand. Amen. We thank God. Amen. We're going to be orchestrating our trip to the Lake Charles area, really Vinton. And I'll let us know what we'll be doing. Amen. I want to share this on tonight. I want to share this on tonight. And I have to, and just to see. There is a time right now where I've been asked to do a baptism, amen, for someone who gave their life to Christ. And I know during this pandemic, we haven't been able to go, amen, to church and do baptism and go to church and that normal thing. And if it's any of you, anybody listening, and you say, Pastor, I've given my life to Christ since the pandemic, but I haven't been baptized, right? I want you to reach out to me. Amen. Reach out to me. Amen. Use the church messenger. Amen. Amen. You can scroll it across the screen. Whatever you want to do, it's up to you. Amen. Say yeah or nay, it's up to you. But baptism is an act of obedience of what happens on the inside to show that, guess what? You go in, amen, one way, you come out another. It signifies new life in Christ, right? Dead to sin, but alive in Christ. So there's someone who says that, Pastor, you know, I want to be baptized because since the pandemic, amen, I've accepted Christ and I've never been baptized. And baptism is something that you should do, amen, because you've given your life to Christ as an act of obedience. So I want to submit that to you. If there be anyone out there, you let me know or contact me. And what I'll do is I'll make sure that we can orchestrate something to get that done for you, so you can acknowledge, amen, that new walk with Christ. Amen. God bless you real good. I love you, saints. Amen. Sounds like the weather's about to get bad. So I just want to thank you for tuning in on tonight. Love you here. Some of you support all of the time. You scroll all of the time. You encourage me all of the time. And I want to thank you for that. Amen. And sometimes the encourager needs to be encouraged. So I just want to thank you all for all that you do to support myself as well as St. Mary Missionary Baptist Church. Love you. Amen. God bless you. Amen. And there's nothing you can do about it. Amen. See y'all later. Bye, y'all.